Well, good morning. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. It is good to be here with the church, with the Heritage Bible Church family. And we certainly appreciate those that are watching now via streaming or will be watching us a little bit later. But welcome to the Lord's house. And now let's get started with some announcements by Miss Stephanie.
Good morning. So this upcoming Saturday, the ladies are going to meet here at the church and watch Sabina's Tortured for Christ, the Nazi years. And we're going to just be eating finger foods and movie snacks. And you can bring a comfy lawn chair or blanket or something that would be comfier than these kind of chairs to sit in if you would like. There is a sign-up sheet on the back that you can sign up on. But if you don't sign up and you want to come, come. And then this is the last day to sign up for the new study in the Mary and Martha Sunday School class. So the sign-up sheet is in the back. Make sure you sign up if you're interested because we'll be ordering books this week. And that's it for announcements.
And let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin the worship portion of our service here. Lord, thank you for who you are. We thank you that you love us. You have a plan for us. You have a plan for this church. We thank you that you've already picked out a pastor for us. We don't know who it is, but we seek to do your will as we carry out that task of locating a pastor. And we ask for anointing for the words that Lee's going to be sharing with us here today. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You would please stand for the reading of the word.
Colossians 3, 1 through 4. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Colossians 3, 1 through 4.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life in atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people. The Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice.
in Jesus' name.
So it's been a long time since we've recited the Apostles' Creed, and it's a matter of convenience, I completely understand. Some might even say a little mundane. But those that would be completely against creeds would say something like, "We teach Jesus without the junk." And then I would have to ask them, "Do you have a statement of belief for your church?" Because most churches do. "Do you believe in the Trinity? Do you believe in the age of accountability?" Both concepts that do not directly appear in the text, but are derived from them. I mean, after all, the Bible is 1,189 chapters, and it's kind of hard to fit that all into one paragraph. So here's a quick computer lesson for you. Whenever you want to reference a file in a different location, you can either make a copy of it, which is obviously better, or you can make a pointer to the address, like a shortcut on your desktop. Problem is, the shortcut can be corrupted. That's why a creed as a secondary source would never be better than the primary source. But I think we lose out on a lot of history and culture if we choose to ignore these creeds. I mean, everyone has a worldview, a philosophy, a creative source that they live by. So today I want to talk about creeds and the councils that form them. Let's start off with a word of prayer. Lord, I pray that we may confess you with one voice, that we may remember the sacrifice that you demonstrated for us, and to honor those that have sacrificed in the past, that we may be good stewards of the future. In your name I pray, amen. So in an apostolic age where the New Testament has yet to be written, creeds were a way of passing on teaching, especially to those that were illiterate, and paper was expensive. And this worked especially well for children. In the Bible, creeds were also known as traditions. The word creed comes from the Latin word credo, which means "I believe." Now, creeds do three things. First, they define what we believe so that it is clear for everyone to see. The second is to proclaim what we believe so that we may share with others. And third is to affirm what we believe so that anyone that would repeat these creeds are in agreement. So catechisms are very similar, but those are a reformational development. And creeds tend to be, councils tend to be very reactive. They're more like a band-aid approach. But councils, they also serve three things. They establish doctrine. They also set up the church structure. Various denominations have different combinations of bishops, deacons, and elders. They also serve to deal out church discipline, like excommunication. And we as Protestants, we adhere to 6 out of 7 of the ecumenical councils. Now, ecumenical has a very bad connotation these days, because it's less about doctrine and more about inclusion. And so in place of the 7th council, we adhere to the Synod of Hieria, which rejected icons. Now, synods happen more on the denominational level, and this is a church model that we follow even to this day. And a good example of a council in the Bible would be Acts 15. Now, what was the situation? The Judaizers were telling new Gentile believers that they had to be circumcised and follow the law of Moses in order to be saved. Keyword there being saved. So what did the church decide? They sent out Paul and Barnabas to the council in Jerusalem to consult with the apostles. And what was the resolution? They ruled that new Gentile believers should abstain from pagan practices and abstain from fornication, and then slowly be taught the law of Moses. It was still a requirement, but not for salvation. So now, what good do creeds do for us today as a modern church? The one, they establish doctrine. They set clear guidelines for us as a body to follow so that there's no question about what we believe, how we operate. 2 Peter 1:20 tells us that no prophecy of Scripture is for private interpretation. That doesn't mean that majority rules. But the more eyes on a creed, the more time it has had to be vetted. So it's like Phil said 2 weeks ago, the more we need others in order to master the Word of God. So while Jews look to the future for their salvation, and they still do, we look to the past for ours. And if God's Word never changes, why do people insist on new interpretations? So, I liken creeds to the Constitution. It's a good document, but not everybody adheres to it. It's also good for vetting heresy, so that anyone that stands in this pulpit or teaches our children stick to biblical conservatism. Creeds also simplify teaching for new believers, for our new believers, so that all of us may teach them in a consistent manner, so that they may not be tossed by every wind of doctrine, that we may shape their worldview and give them a foundation, the starting milk of the Word, if you would. Now, is there anybody here that would start in Leviticus with a new believer? No, we start with the gospel, right? Because that's our foundation. Now, 2 Peter 3:16, even Peter admitted that Paul's words were hard to understand. So I want you to remember that verse the next time a Muslim takes a verse out of context. Those of you familiar with classical conversations know that we always start with grammar, then logic, then rhetoric. After all, everyone's a theologian. Creeds are also good for evangelism, prayer, and family devotion. The second reasons that we would use creeds is for unity. Now, Christians have come from every manner of walk of life, right? But Christianity itself has a unique culture and identity. You can go to a brother on the other side of the world, and there's a sense of fellowship there because you have something in common. It's that spirit. Romans 15:6 says that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So yes, we can fellowship with Christians on the other side of the world, but it also ties us to the Christians of the past. See, these creeds serve as battle markers for the different struggles that have happened throughout history. And if we choose to ignore the significance of these battles, then it loses meaning. It's kind of like the Ichthus fish, which was once a symbol of persecution and is now a decal sold in liberal bookstores. See, I've been at this church for a long time. And discussing and debating, I know the wide range of different beliefs that we have here. But we can still fellowship with one another because we agree on the majors and we're free to debate the minors. It's also the same reason that we can fellowship with other churches like Covenant and St. Andrew's. In a perfect world, we would all agree on interpretation to every jot and tittle, but it's not a perfect world on this side of heaven. Some churches don't allow instruments and singing at the same time. Some speak in tongues. Some ordain lesbian atheists. Doctrine divides. That's just the nature of it. It's the nature of following John 14:6, which says that no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. What does light have to do with darkness? 2 Corinthians 6:14. That's why we don't fellowship with the Muslims over yonder, or the Mormons down the road, or the Hindus on the other side of 77. And the third reason for creeds is that it should prevent you from being a social justice warrior. Yes, it should prevent you from being a social justice warrior and turn you into God's justice warrior. The problem with the SJW movement is that it's defined by the world instead of being defined by Scripture. And activists demonstrate the same hatred as the discrimination they claim to fight against. So I have here an excerpt from the Southern Baptist Confession, Faith and Message. You might be able to read that. So what we're starting to see surface in more recently has been decay of bad leadership over the past couple of years. We're starting to see pastors that we thought were conservative capitulate to liberal ideas. And of the things that are being debated by the convention right now include homosexuality, sexual abuse, and women as pastors. Even Dr. Al Mohler, who signed the preamble to this message, has been very selective on what he's willing to stand up for. More details offline. But it just goes to show that we shouldn't be of Apollos or Paul or any flawed man. Hebrews 10:38 tells us that God does not delight in those that shrink back from him. After the manner of Spurgeon, your righteousness is activism. Away with you. Yes, we should treat people with love, kindness, and compassion. But at some point, you have to draw the line. What are you willing to die for? Now, I don't know what your interactions with unbelievers have been like. 1 Peter 4:4 tells us that they will scoff at us for not joining in their reckless living. Having grown up around unbelievers and been one myself, there's always this itch to push Christians on what they believe, and they will continue to push and press until you cave. But honestly, it doesn't matter whether you cave or not, because they just want to justify their sin. And so in the same manner, an activist, they'll mock you for not joining in their cause. They'll call you a hypocrite because you don't share the same sense of justice, even though you're a Christian. They might even guilt you for events that happened way before you were even born. And they might even turn your kids against you. But this is just the package deal of being a Christian. God, Jesus warned us that we would be mocked and insulted and defamed. So the next time someone asks you to join a revolution, I want you to think about these events. Not all revolutions are bad, some maybe even necessary. But think about the Jews at Masada, the French Revolution, Mao's Communist China, and the sexual revolution. James 4:4 tells us that those that are friends with the world are at enmity with God. Brothers and sisters, we do not want to be on the wrong side of history because we feared man rather than God. But now that we got that out of the way, why don't we look at some creeds? I'll just be doing a brief overview of different ones found throughout history, and I'd like to start with the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. These words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them as signs on your hands. They shall be as frontlets between your eyes, also known as phylacteries. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. The word Shema means to hear, but also means to obey. This was given to the Jews after they had tested God at Massa. It was an invitation for a blessing or a curse. It was a reminder of what God had done for them in Egypt. And I think the instructions are pretty clear here. You know, Jesus told us to never stop praying. And this comes pretty close. Yeah. Is it any wonder that this is the greatest commandment? And if God took it seriously, I think we should too. For our next set, this comes from the New Testament. Dr. Gary Habermas of Liberty University has identified several verses that could have been used as creeds in the Bible by early Christians. Even secular scholars agree with him on these findings on the historical accuracy of the Bible, even Bart Ehrman. The way you identify a creed in the Bible is the use of the word kaihoti, which means and that, and the use of non-Pauline words. So our first creed is Romans 10:9. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So additionally, we can tell this is a creed because Paul tells us we must confess it, but also because saying so could be a death sentence. You see, emperor worship was particularly troubling under Domitian. Citizens would be called to the town square, and they would be required to offer a pinch of incense to the emperor, and they would be required to proclaim Caesar Kyrios, Caesar is Lord. But if you were to proclaim Christos Kyrios, Christ is Lord, you could be thrown in jail. And while the Jews were exempt from this, Christians were not. Our next verse, Philippians 2:6-11, says, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So this is known as the kenosis hymn, which basically means emptying. This was thought to be sung by Christians at their execution, possibly as an acknowledgement of the way that Jesus died. And the next one is possibly my favorite. Right. 1 Corinthians 15:3-7. It says, for I have delivered to you as of first importance what I have also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with our spirit, with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to the more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive. Though some have fallen, he has appeared to James, then all the apostles. Okay. So there's The second part of verse 6 was most likely added in by Paul. So this creed has been traced somewhere around 30 to 35 AD, depending on the actual year of the crucifixion. So that's as early as a couple months after Jesus' resurrection to a couple years afterwards. And depending on the time, the year of Paul's conversion, that would be when it was given to him, somewhere 6 to 11 years post-resurrection. Now, even Paul was a disciple at one point. Galatians 1, 18 through 19 tells us that after preaching 3 years in Antioch, he went to Jerusalem to talk with Peter and James to see if what he was preaching would match up with what they were. So now we'll be looking at some creeds found throughout history, starting with the Apostles' Creed, the one and only. This is a very popular baptismal creed, translated in at least 20 languages that I know of, also known as the Old Roman Creed. And while it was not written by the apostles, it can be derived from the teachings of the early church fathers, which it gets pretty close. And moving on, we have quite a big word here. Does anyone here know what this controversy was about? What was that?
I said I can't even pronounce it.
Oh, okay. Okay, so this was about Easter. And while I can't justify Christmas for you, Easter was always meant to follow after Passover, after the 14th month of Aviv. And it was meant to be in parallel with the spring festivals of the Old Testament. Passover represented Christ's blood. The Feast of Unleavened Bread represented Christ's broken body. The Feast of First Fruits represented Christ's resurrection. Our next one is Council of Nicaea. So if you ever decide to study this creed, it's basically an expanded version of the Apostles' Creed. And the Heritage Statement of Belief follows the same format. An important thing to note about this council is that it's the first time that Christianity has become tolerated under Constantine. This was not when Constantine made Christianity the state religion, as opponents will tell you. And even Constantine's supposed conversion happened much later in life. This is also not when Gnosticism formed Christianity. At this point, Gnosticism was already much long dead, and it shares much more with Eastern mysticism than it does with Christianity. And this is also not when the canon was formed, a myth postulated by Voltaire, who suggested that the books were of the New Testament were decided by throwing a bunch of manuscripts on a table and then see what fell off. This myth was also popularized by the movie Da Vinci Code. So at this point, 21 out of 27 of the New Testament books were already widely accepted, widely being the key word here. While there were many different things discussed at these councils, the one I want to focus on is the deity of Christ. Now, there were two major players here, Athanasius and Arius. Arius believed that Jesus was a created being, but when it came time to vote, only 2 out of 300 bishops voted with him. So Arius ends up getting exiled. But this whole discussion gets very political in nature. So years later, Eusebius, who was a friend of Arius, later convinces Constantine to bring back Arius and exile Athanasius. But at this point, Arius was already dead. And while Athanasius does get exiled, the Nicene Creed ends up winning out in the end. So you would think that would settle the matter on Christ's deity, but Jesus' deity gets questioned on all other ways. At the Council of Constantinople, Apollinarius said that Jesus was not fully human. He was just an illusion. But 2 John 1:7 tells us that Jesus indeed came in the flesh. At the Council of Ephesus, Nestorius questioned Christ's personhood. He suggested that Christ was two beings in one body. He also questioned whether we could call Mary Theotokos, the bearer of God, or Christokos, only Christokos, bearer of Christ. At Chalcedon, this is where we established that God was indeed fully God, fully man, as also known as the hypostatic union. At the Second Council of Constantinople, it basically just reaffirmed the first four. And at the Third Council, it was debated whether Christ had two conflicting wills, his God will and his human will. What history tells us is that What history tells us is that heresies just get dug up and rebranded. There's nothing new under the sun. The teaching that Jesus was a created being is a teaching of the Jehovah Witnesses. The problem with this teaching is that, one, created beings have proven that they have fallen into temptation, and two, who else could endure the wrath of God, come back from hell, resurrect, and return to his throne in heaven? Our next creed is the Barmen Declaration, also known as Clarification in German. This is Nazi Germany, and the church has become status. Hitler has taken over the church, and he issues the Aryan paragraph. He decreed that the Old Testament be removed, because it's a Jewish book, that all church members would submit loyalty to the Führer, and that any Jewish converts be removed from positions of power. So in response, three men had a particularly significant position. Okay, so three men had a significant, what am I trying to say? So three men had a particular hand in drafting of the Barmen Declaration. So it was Martin E. Moeller, our pal Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and Karl Barth. If you're not familiar with Neo Moeller's name, you might have heard his poem. First they came for the socialists, and I said nothing because I wasn't a socialist. Then they came for the Jews, and I said nothing because I wasn't a Jew. Then they came for the trade unionists. I said nothing because I wasn't a trade unionist. Then they came for the Catholics because I was a Protestant. And then when they came for me, there was no one left. So the Barmen Declaration made 6 points. One, the Bible was the only divine source of revelation. Two, Jesus is the only Lord of the church. Three, there should be separation of church and state. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Four, there is no global earthly leader. Five, the church and the government have separate tasks. And six, the church does not submit to the state, and the Bible does not submit to the church. It also calls its hearers to test the spirits, to see whether these things are from God. And I personally would have added Ephesians 4:5, one faith, one Lord, one baptism. Listen to the words of Karl Barth. He says, "No other major institution offers significant resistance to the Nazi menace. Not the universities, not the legal profession, not the business, not the arts, not the army, not the trade unions, only the church. These words were echoed even by Einstein, and Barth's only regret is that he did not do more, that they did not do more and act sooner. Now our last piece is more of a bonus. That came too soon. So the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. So you might wonder how this is a creed. I would suggest that you watch Ray Comfort's The Fool, and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Throughout the Bible, God has demonstrated his power in odd ways. With Gideon, he takes 300 men, and he has them fight with trumpets and torches. With Joshua, he has them walk around Jericho walls for 6 days. With Ezekiel, he has him lay on his side, tied up, cooking his food over dung. It may have felt weird at the moment, but those that had faith saw God work. Jesus didn't come as a man of high status, though he could have. He didn't come as a man with riches, though he could have. He didn't come as a man with good looks, though he could have. He came as an everyday commoner, just like you and me. So our bonus piece. This was found in the former mansion of Caligula on Palatine Hill. It can now be seen at the Palatine Museum. And while the rendering on the right looks like it was drawn by a 5-year-old, whoever made the actual etching on the left, I think the sentiment is pretty clear. They believe that we serve a crucified A-word. There was no honor in crucifixion. Crucifixion was reserved for slaves and lower class. They were most likely naked, not covered with a loincloth, as modern depictions show. Some even staked through the groin. It's hard for me to think of a modern example, but I liken it to be covered in tar, rolled in feathers, and sent to the chopping block. So I think, to close out the sermon, why don't we all recite the Apostles' Creed for one last time? I believe in the God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the only God's Son, Lord, conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Third day, he rose from the dead. Ascended to heaven, sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And there come the judge, living and dead. Believe in the Holy Spirit, Holy Christian Church, communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. Yes.
Because I have been reciting this prayer, where you come down, I believe in the Holy Spirit. I wonder if what I say is I believe in the believer's church rather than, you know, because I'm reading from the Catholic version, so I don't want to say the Catholic church, but believers, because there are many denomination people that are coming together to believe in Jesus Christ. Do you think it's acceptable to do that, or do we have to stick with what we're getting from the past?
You're asking if it's okay to say Catholic?
No, it's okay to say the believer's church. Ah. Rather than the Holy Christian Church, the believer's church.
Yeah. I don't see a problem with that.
If
have no piano player, so unless someone wants to do And bonus points to Lee because he got to say hypostatic union in the sermon before I did, so I'm a little jealous.
So I'll preach next week, and I'll try to keep it closer to this time because maybe you'll have questions or something after I preach. If I preach long enough, then you can't question it. But there you go. I'll have to keep it short so you can ask me questions. Next week. You do. She's well. Okay.
Just as I am without one. But that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am, tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fear and fears without, O Lamb of God.
Father, we thank you for this lesson in your word today. We thank you for providing this facility for us to meet in without fear of persecution. And as we leave these doors today, we ask that you would help us to be the same people out there that we are in here. I ask it in your son's name. Amen.